What do I do?
Can you go ahead and subtract it?
No, I cannot do that. Other suggestions? Copy the base. 3 times 1/4 is 3/4. Copy the base. 2/1 times 1/4 is 1/2. Is that clear so far? Now copy the base and multiply the exponents. 5/2. Copy the base, multiply the exponents, 1/2. Is this okay so far? Are you with me? Okay. Any questions? Of course, these two are the same, so they're gone. And now I copy the base. What happens with the exponents? Yes, from 3/4, I subtract 5/2. Least common denominator, and this one needs a 2. So we have 3 minus 10. Do you agree with 3 minus 10? Over 4. Good. And we are easing into our next rule. This is rule. Exactly. Exactly. That's what I'm going to write. And I'm coming back to that problem. 10. A radical expression is fully simplified if 3 conditions are fulfilled. If, number 1, no negative exponents are present in the final answer. No negative exponents are present in the final answer. One more time, a radical expression is fully simplified if no negative if no negative exponents are present in the final answer. Number 2, all radicals are fully simplified. That means power less than the index. Always. I'll explain what that means. All radicals in that radical expression, all radicals at the end must be fully simplified, meaning the power inside that m has to be smaller than n, which is the index. I'll show you in a minute. And the last one, last condition, no radicals in the denominator. So 3 conditions have to be fulfilled in order for us to say this radical expression is fully simplified. No negative exponents in the final answer, no radicals in the denominator, and all radicals have the power of the radicand less than the index, not even equal to the index. Okay? So now I have to continue with this. Why? This is not fully simplified because condition number 1 is not fulfilled. So let's analyze that. So our problem is x raised to negative 7/4. What does this equal to then? In order to fulfill the first condition, what does it equal to?
1/x.
Very good. 1/x^7/4. But now, what is x^7/4? What does it represent? It represents, very good, excellent. Which, true, I'll get to that in a minute. Very good. The 4/x^7. So now, if for this particular problem, this is fulfilled, but this is not. All radicals are fully simplified if the power inside, the power of the radicand, is less than the index. That's not true here. I see 7, which is higher than 4. So how do I split? I have to split x to the 7 into two different pieces. X to some power multiplied by x to another power, such that this product is x to the 7th, but at least one of these two, one of them, is a perfect fourth. So here's how I do it. 7 over 4, an integer? No. Go back 1. 6 over 4, is that an integer? No. Go back 1. 5 over 4, is that an integer? No. Go back 1. 4 over 4, yes. So this must be 4 and this must be 3.
What?
7 divided by 4 an integer? No. 6 divided by 4 an integer? No. 5 divided by 4 an integer? No. 4 divided by 4 an integer? Yes. 4 and 3. So
there,
you just take the integers out from 7 fourths. 1 and 3 fourths. You take the integers out from 7 fourths. It's 1 integer and 3 fourths as the remainder. Same thing. I prefer this one because I think it's easier to explain, but use the method you like.
So that's the final answer.
No.
Oh.
So I replaced this by this. First of all, you have to tell me that you agree, because if you don't agree, it means that it's not clear and I have to go back. So do we agree with that? Do we agree that the fourth root of x to the seventh is identical with the fourth root of x to the fourth times the fourth root of x to the third? Do we agree with that? Good. This can be simplified into what? Very good. Assuming everything is positive, it's just x, correct? And now I have the cube root of x to the third. I'm coming back to rule number 10. One more time. No negative exponents in the final answer. Correct. That's done. All radicals are fully simplified. The power inside is less than the index. That is true now.
Sorry.
That is true now. The power is indeed less than the index. Now I'm facing the last situation, right? This is where I'm right now. It says no radicals in the denominator. Let's see how we do that. Okay. Here's a question for you before I come back to this. If I say the square root of 2, and I want to multiply it by something so that I get just 2, what would that something be? Say it again. Yes, it must be the same index, of course. Thank you. It must be the same index. And what is underneath? If I put 4, this will be the square root of 8. No, that's not 2. If I put 5, that will be the square root of 10. That's not 2. So what do I... Exactly. Absolutely. The square root of 2 times the square root of 2 is 2. Good. Stay with me. What if I say now the cube root of 2? What will you multiply it by to get 2? And you cannot say the square root because it has to have the same index. So, but what am I missing now? This time I want a perfect cube, but I only have 1 2. How many 2s do I need? If I only write this, it's not going to happen because the cube root of 4 is not 2. So I have only 1, and I need to form a perfect cube. How many am I missing? I am missing 2, indeed. Because the cube root of 2 times the cube root of 2 squared is the cube root of 8, which is indeed 2. Okay, one more. Let's say I have the fourth root of 3 squared. And I'm asking you to tell me what to multiply it by to get just plain 3, nothing else. What will you say? It has to be the fourth root. If I put 3 to the third, then I'm in trouble. Because 3 to the fifth, 5 over 4 is not an integer. So how many am I missing? I'm not missing three, because I need to form a perfect fourth. And I have, I'm missing exactly two. And that is true now. Okay, let's try one more. Let's say I have the seventh root of x squared. What do I not multiply it by to get plain x? Yes, it has to be the seventh root, right? Because I'm forming a perfect seven now, and it has to be x to the... Exactly.
This makes sense.
Good. Excellent. Which means this will be very easy then. So now I'm back to my problem, and I have to multiply top and bottom because I cannot multiply just the top I have or the bottom. I have to multiply by one. And will you tell me what I need to, if you don't, just don't look at this one for a moment. Yes, exactly, 1x. So this will be the fourth root of x. How much is this then? That's why you picked the fourth root of x. Exactly, but I have to multiply it by the x in front. It happens to be x squared. Now all conditions are fulfilled. This radical is done. This radical expression is fully simplified. It has no negative exponents in the final answer. The radicand, the powers of the radicands are smaller than the index, 1 and 4, and there are no radicals in the denominator. The last step is called rationalizing the denominator. Say it again. Yes, it has millions of steps. This problem has millions of steps. I agree. So let's write this.
So what's the final answer?
The fourth root of x over x squared. This is x times x in front, x squared.
How do you get the x?
Which one? This one?
Yes.
I have a perfect fourth to form. I have three of those. I'm missing one.
Okay.
I only need one more. So the process of eliminating the radical from the denominator is called rationalizing the denominator. One more time. The process of eliminating the radical from the denominator or from the denominators is called rationalizing the denominator. I promised a lot of rules in this chapter, didn't I? This is the last one, however. This is the last one, I promise.
So, this is the last rule?
This is the last rule, yeah. We're done with the rules. Good. Okay, 79. On page 602. We are trying to simplify this. But you can say, wait a minute, it's already simplified. The radicand under the eighth root, both factors have a power less than the index. What more do you want? Here's what I want. In order to try to simplify this, first I'm going to replace it by what I know I can split it into. And then I will change the first one into x to 4 over 8. The second one, of course, into 4 over 8. And I will simplify these two fractions. And 4 over 8 reduces to 1 half, and then y to 1 half. And now I'm ready to go back to the same radical, but this time is an easier radical to work with. What radical is this?
Square.
Very good. So the square root of xy. So, yes.
That's it.
So we reduce the eighth root to a square root, which is easier to work with. Okay, let's try and see if we can reduce this one, which is 81, which is the 12th root of a to the eighth, b to the fourth. Although this chapter looks kind of difficult and hectic and all over the place, I have to say that students do very well on this test. Because like it's like a little puzzle or something, and once you understand the rules, you will do very well, very well. And I was pleased with the results. I wanted to say that. I forgot. Sorry. I was very pleased. A lot of A's and A pluses, and very nice. I'm very happy. Thank you. Okay, so I want to reduce this. Now, I have to be careful when how I reduce this one, because I will write A to 8 over 12 and B to 4 over 12. So I can reduce 8 over 12 by simplifying by 4, and I get 8 to 2 thirds, and I'll simplify B, and I get 1 third. Since the denominators are the same, then I will go back and say the cube root of A squared B. But now when you reduce those two fractions and the denominators are not the same, you have to find the least common denominator, because you have to have only one radical at the end. So careful on that. Any questions for me? Any questions? Okay, let's do more simplification. It's all about the same thing, going back and forth with the rules. From left to right and from back from right to left. It looks like it's a lot, and I would say it's a lot, but when you sit down and start studying this, you'll see it's not that difficult. Okay, we're asked to simplify the cube root of 10 times the cube root of 5. Since they have the same index, I will copy the index and multiply the two radicands, and I get 50. And that's it. I'm allowed to multiply the cube root of 10 by the cube root of 5. Because if you remember the rule, the cube root of A times B is the cube root of A times the cube root of B. And now I went backwards. The cube root of 10 times the cube root of 5 is the cube root of 50. Let's look at problem 12. The fourth root of AB squared multiplied by the fourth root of 27AB. Yeah, they have the same index. I can multiply them. And can anyone give us the radicand of this product? Of these? Indeed. The fourth. Right. Good. That's it. Yes. Careful, this is 3 to the third, but the power is less than the index. The power is less than the index. The power is less than the index. This is fully simplified. I can't do anything.
Wait, do you have to put the 3 to the third?
No, but I wanted to see if I could take the fourth root. Since it's 3 to the third, I cannot take the fourth root of it. But if it were 81, then it would have been 3. Because 81 is 3 to the fourth. And the fourth root of 3 to the fourth is 3. So that's why I wanted to see. Oh, but I remember 27. Oh, it's 3 to the third. There is nothing I can do to further simplify this. Okay, I would like to look at 27 on page 610. The square root of 5x squared over 4y squared. Any questions so far? Okay, so first I will split into 5x squared, the square root, and 4y squared. And then I will split in the square root of 5, oops, square root of 5, the square root of x squared over the square root of 4, thank you, the square root of y squared. The square root of 5 is the square root of 5. The square root of x squared, assuming everything is positive, this will be just x. the square root of 4 will be 2, and the square root of y squared will be y. And this is it. We prefer not write anything behind the radical. So instead of writing this, I recommend writing this. And you can say, but that's a contradiction with what you said before, when you said the numbers have to be in front of variables. True. It is somewhat of a contradiction. But see, it is possible that I could make the mistake and extend the radical on top of x, and that would be wrong. But if I leave the radical at the very end, there is nothing else that follows behind it, so I will not make that mistake to extend it over something that it shouldn't be extended over. Okay, now the next set of problems is a little bit more involving, but we have to be careful and patient with this because this is very important. So I'm looking at problems 31 through 60 on 610. And we can choose as many as you want from here. And I'm going to start with 51. And this is the cube root of 50x to the 14th. We already worked on something like this before. I just wanted to say that we have to be patient with this. Okay, well, I will split in the cube root of 50 and the cube root of x to the 14th. Is there a perfect cube in 50? Can I find anything that I multiply, two numbers that I multiply, and one of them is a perfect cube and the other one is not? No, 50 is just 5 times 10 or 2 times 25. There is nothing else. And none of them is a perfect square, a perfect cube. So there is nothing I can do to the cube root of 50. So this is fully simplified. However, this one is not, because the power is 14 and the index is 3. So obviously I have to split it into two. X to a power and x to another power. Can anyone give us... Exactly what we just did. 14 over 3. Mm-mm. 13 over 3. Mm-mm. 12 over 3. Yes. Any questions?
Oh, you started, you go down. So
yes. Yes, because this is what I have. I have 14 over 3, but 14 over 3 doesn't work. So if 14 over 3 doesn't work, then I have to go back to 13. 13 over 3 doesn't work. And then I'll say, oops, okay, let me go back one. And I find 12. 12 over 3 is fine. So that's where I stop. So therefore, I have the cube root of 50. I have the cube root of x to the 12th. And I have the cube root of x squared. Only one of these can be simplified. Which one can be simplified? Exactly. And what will you replace the middle one by? That's it. This will go in front, and then the cube root will collect these two together again. We'll put them together, and this is the simplified form of this radical. Any questions? Just wanted to put in my attendance before I forget. Say it again. Why do we do 14 into 12 and 2? 14 over 3 is not divisible. 13 over 3 is not divisible. 12 over 3 is. So I stop at 12.
So you stop there. So you stop there.
Yes, because 12 over 3 is an integer. Yes. Is that okay? We only had two examples like that, so it's not good enough. That's why I'm here, and we're going to work on more. So here's the next problem. Let's say 53. And negative outside, which doesn't bother anyone. The square root of 32, a to the 8th, b to the 7th. What is the first step?
Seven.
Yes, absolutely. That's the first rule I apply. Although, if you can simplify it without splitting it, I'm fine. You can skip this step if you want to. When I present this, I never skip it because I think it really helps. But when you become experts with these radicals, you can, of course.
So the 8 to the 8th power?
Yes, 8 to the 8th. Okay, Noah is not here. He's here. Let's see. Nicole Tash. Dexter Price. Marie. Very good. Thank you. So then, which of these three radicals you like and which of these you don't? I claim I only like one of them. Which one? Exactly. Because this is a to the... Very good. But these need work. Here I have to find a perfect square, and here I have to split it, because 7 over 2 is not an integer. So then, what do I do?
So the 32 and the common number that's
the perfect
square?
Yes. Let's say I don't know anything about 32, okay? Here's what I will present it in prime factorization. It's an even number, so it must be divisible by 2. And then I got to 16, and I'm done.
Oh, because it came to 4.
What about 7? B to the 7th power, I meant to say. How are you going to split B to the 7th? I'm sorry? Because 16 is a perfect square, that's why I stopped. Yep. B to the 7th. How do I split this? I'm sorry? 7 over 2 is not an integer. I have to split it. You went too far.
Oh, to the
6. Exactly. And B. Very good. So then we have negative. The square root of 16... The square root of 2, a to the 4th, which is done, the square root of b to the 6th, and the square root of b.
When you're splitting it?
This one? I just rewrote it. I rewrote the square root of b to the 6th instead of b to the 7th. I rewrote this. The square root of b to the 6th times the square root of b. 4, it comes from here. It's a to the 4th. These two come from here. So instead of the square root of 32, I wrote the square root of 16 times the square root of 2.
How'd you get 6 again? How do you base it?
7 over 2. No. 6 over 2?
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So 7 is 6 plus 1. So then the square root of 16 is 4. Then we have a to the 4th. And then the square root of b to the 6th is b to the 3rd. But these have to stay. So this is back to the square root of 2b.
Okay,
say it again. Yes, we cannot simplify the square root of 2. It has to stay under the square root. Any questions? Let's look at another. Like 57. Any questions for me, please? I'll stop right now for a second and please ask anything you want. Fifty-seven is the cube root of 125, r to the 9th, s to the 12th. Cube root of 125, r to the 9th, s to the 12th. So what do I have to do first? Yes, I recommend that. 125, r to the 9th, and s to the 12th. Good. Now? The cube root. The cube. It's 5 indeed. Very good. The cube root of r to the 9th. R to the? Yes, very good. And then s to the? Good. Everything was nice and clear for this one. I didn't have to split anything. I didn't have to do anything. I just had to apply the definition of radicals. Okay, let's look now at 59. And then we look at some ratios. The 4th root of 32, x to the 12th, y to the 5th. Any questions?
When do these type of problems come up in real life situations?
It's first of all, you're training your brain. When I was your age, I would say the same thing, and then I was sorry that I didn't learn it. I really was. With a lot of things. I could have done much better if I had trained my brain in a variety of things.
I'm pretty sure the policemen and firefighters, if you ask them how to do this, they'll probably
look at this. Well, I'm hoping that you're going to do way more than that. I'm hoping you're going to go to medical school or pharmacy, school of pharmacy, or so many other different things. I'm hoping that you're not going to, with your education, just say, oh, I'm happy with this but or with that, but you go much higher. That's my hope for each and every student I have. Okay, the 4th root of 32. The 4th root of x to the 12th. And the 4th root of y to the 5th. I only like one of these two, of these three. Yes. Why do I like the middle one? Because it's straightforward. How much is this? And it's done. Yes, x to the 3rd. Excellent. But now on 32 I have to work. And it's the 4th root. I cannot say, it happens that I can say 16 and 2. Because 16 is a perfect square as well as a perfect fourth. It happens. Now what do I do with y to the 5th, knowing that the index is 4? Exactly. Because 5 over 4 doesn't work. I go back 1, and 4 over 4 is an integer. I stop at 4, and the remainder is 1. Very good. So, you can rewrite it. You can skip this step, but I will write it. The 4th root of 16, the 4th root of 2, x to the 3rd, the 4th root of y to the 4th, and the 4th root of y. All of them must be the 4th root. So now I know, and I will show you in a minute about real life situation, because it was a very good question, and I'll show you when we apply these. Okay, this I know is 2. This is x to the 3rd. And this I know is what?
No.
Very good. So now this is out. Now these two are still in. Or under the 4th root.
So we leave it like that?
Yes, that's it. We cannot do anything else because the index is 4, the power is 1. Power 1, we already have accomplished this. Gee, was it that far back? Wow. Okay, so no negative exponents in the final answer. All radicands are fully simplified. The power is less than the index, and no radicals in the denominators or denominator. Good, now let's look at some denominators situations. Like, for example, 67. Same page, 610. And this is the square root of x to the fifth, y to the third, divided by the square root of xy. Although I promise no more rules, but there is one thing that I want to add. Not as a rule if you want, but as an observation. Okay. I want you to see the difference between these two. Here's one situation. I didn't mean that. I meant this. Let me write it one more time. And this situation. Yeah, I'm coming back to that. Yeah, I want you to see the difference between these two, and then I come back to that. Okay. In this situation, of course, the indices are the same. But I see the same factor under the top radical, and I see the same factor, or maybe factors, in the denominator radical. So there is a point, and I have to write the whole thing under the same root, because I will be able to simplify. Simplify an x from here and with an x from here, and the simplified form is this. Of course, I still have a lot of work to do because no radicals in the denominator. But here, there is no point in writing this. It's not going to help me. It's not wrong. But I won't be able to simplify because 2 and 3 have no common factors. So now I'm coming back to my problem. I see the same index, because if it's not the same index, I can do. I have to do something else. I see the same index, but I also see the same factors underneath. So, of course, this will help me. Otherwise, I would have not done this. If I had a factor at the top that is totally different from the factor in the denominator, this is okay, but it will not help in simplifying. Okay, so then...
Will we have examples when we don't have the same index?
Yes. I'll show you an example. I'll show you... We already did, but we changed them into an exponential notation.
Oh.
Yes. So that's good enough. But I can show you other examples, but we still have to change them into exponential notation. Okay, so here I have x to the fifth over x. So this is x to the fourth. And y cubed over y, which is y squared. And now the final answer is clear. If you split it or not, the final answer is nice and clean. What is it? Exactly. Excellent. X squared y. And it's done. Let's look at another couple of examples with ratios now before we look at the distance and midpoint formula. And yes, that's the end of the rules, I promise. Okay, 74. We have the fourth root again at the top and the fourth root at the bottom. And the top is from 160, x to the 10th, y to the 5th. And the bottom is from 2x squared, y squared. Is there a point, you think, in writing everything under one index? It, because I can simplify, of course. Yes. Good. So then I write 160, x to the 10th, y to the 5th, over 2, x squared, y squared. You cannot simplify without rewriting it under one radical. You cannot say, oh, I cross out this from here and a 2 from here. You cannot do that. That's the first step you have to perform, because it's one of the rules of the radicals. In other words, the fourth root over the fourth root can be rewritten as the fourth root of the ratio. And now I'm going to simplify. So I have the fourth root. 160 over 2 is 80. X to the 10th over x squared is x to the 8th. And y to the 5th over y squared is y to the 3rd. Are we okay with this? And yes, I will split it. And to tell you the truth, now I like two of those, not just one. Which two I like? No, I like this one because it's x squared, and I like this one because there is nothing I can do to it. The power is smaller than the index, and it's done. I don't like this one because I have to split it. And I have to find a perfect fourth in 80. So what is the perfect fourth in 80? 16 it is. Thank you. So this is 16 and 5? Good. So now this is the fourth root of 16 times the fourth root of 5 times x squared times the fourth root of y cubed. Only this one can be simplified, which is a 2, x squared. And these two have to go back under the same radical where they came from. So this is multiplied by the fourth root of 5y cubed. Yes, and then I go back and collect everything under the same thing. Same radical, yes. Any questions?
That first one that you have circled, how did you get 2x squared?
The fourth root of 16 is 2, and then I copied x squared from here, and then these two are here. Better? Okay. Let's do one more. And then we'll look at the distance and midpoint formula. So this is 75 on page 610. Again, if you feel that we need more examples from a particular problem, please, after you redo all problems we did in class, please make a list. And we'll do more problems. 2x cubed, y to negative 7. Yes, I will rewrite it with one radical, 64x to the 10th, y to the 3rd, over 2x to the 3rd, y to negative 7. I didn't do anything, I just rewrote the problem. What will you tell me to write next? What is left under the fifth root? Very good. X to the, very good. And Y to the, yes, 3 minus negative 7. Very good. I will split this. And I do like two of those. Which one I don't like? Yes, that's the only one I don't like. Because I know the fifth root is, and I know the fifth root of y to the 10th is good. So I only have to split So this is 2y squared, and then how do I present the fifth root of x to the seventh? The fifth root of x to the seventh must be rewritten as the fifth root of x to the, no, because 6 over 5 is not an integer. 7 over 5 is not, 6 over 5 is not, 5 over 5 is. So then I have to split 7 into 5 and 2. Is that okay? No, I have to simplify it. So this is 2xy squared, the fifth root of x squared. Good. Let's talk about the distance.